Welcome everyone. There is more scientific evidence now on how mobile health technologies are helping health program outcomes. Today we have experts with us who will share more on what we call mHealth. At the outset of this webinar today, let me request all participants to please keep sending your questions while the panelists present. No need to wait till the end. Just type your questions using chat function or raise your virtual hand, which you will see on your screen. Without any further ado, let me welcome today's webinar moderator, Ashok Ramaswaroop. Ashok Ramaswaroop is a widely acclaimed international journalist based in Durban, South Africa, with over 40 years of rich experience in journalism. He was senior producer at South African Broadcasting Corporation. Over to you, Ashok. Ashok, please unmute yourself. I think you have muted yourself. Please unmute yourself. Ashok, please unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes,
hello.
Yes.
Lovely
hello,
meeting.
We can hear you.
Can I go ahead?
Greetings
please, from Durban, South Africa. Mobile health or mHealth is being used by TV programs in some high burden countries. A recent study published in June 2017 shows that presumptive TB case referral by healthcare providers using mHealth went up manifold. Currently, it is estimated that TB services are not reaching every person in need. To end TB, there is no further spread of TB, as well as every person with TB gets accurately diagnosed, treated with effective drugs, and cured. Can mHealth technologies help accelerate progress towards the goal of ending TB by 2030 globally, SDGs. We have a luminary panel of experts who will share important insights today. Without much delay, let me introduce the panel of experts for this first session. Dr. Sunitha Nareddy is a senior infectious diseases expert with the Apollo Hospitals in Hyderabad, India. Dr. Nareddy is American board certified in infectious diseases and did a medical studies from the world famous Christian Medical College, CMC Vellore, in infectious diseases from Wayne State University in the United States of America. And his research and clinical work spans multi-drug resistant TB, infections in immunocompromised hosts, among others. Dr. Archana Taveri, alumni of prestigious King's George's Medical University, or KGMU, 53 years of experience of Indian Army Medical Corps and public health. Currently, she is with Southeast Asia Office of International Union Against Tuberculosis and Lung Disease, or the Union, as a senior technical advisor. Dr. Archana has got hands-on experience in developing innovative ICT, information communication technology tools, in engagement of qualified and informal healthcare providers in TB care and control. She has demonstrated use of mobile-based management system in case detection, case holding, and treatment completion of tuberculosis in tribal rural settings. She has over 30 papers presentations in international and national conferences. And another panelist, Dr. Charles Sandy, is a Deputy Director of National AIDS and TB Program, Zimbabwe. Thanks to Dr. Sandy, Dr. Devedi, and Dr. Nadi for joining us, our panel of experts today. Now, let us listen to our first expert, Dr. Sunitha Nareddy. senior diseases expert from Apollo Hospitals. To you, Dr. Narvedi.
Thank you, Dr. Shobha and Ashna, for organizing this. Today, I'm going to be talking to you about the model of mobile health that we have used in our hospital in terms of TB notification and to help adherence system. And this is a pilot project that we are doing, and we are expanding this into other places. So just a background of what TB is like in India. If you look at the 2011 statistics from WHO, there's approximately about 2.6 million TB cases in India a year, and probably about 1 million TB cases that are missed annually. Why does this happen? Because in the private sector, it's a huge difference in kinds of private sector providers, and this is lack of standardization in terms of diagnostic and treatment practices. There are quite a bit of unregulated care that goes on. There are doctors from the allopathic medicine, Unani medicine, the registered medical practitioners, Ayurvedic doctors, a varied kind of medical practitioners, and there's no standardization in any of these areas. This results to a lot of confusion, and also notification was only recently started. Until a few years ago, we did not have notification. We do have notification now, but the notification itself is being very poor. In the private sector, unfortunately, there is no mechanism for monitoring treatment adherence. If the patient does not follow up with the physicians, does not come back for follow-up as advised, there is no way the physician who is taking care of the patient knows that the patient has not come back. This results in incomplete and irregular treatment, which increases the probability of drug resistance. Once you develop drug resistance, there's a lot of problem in terms of increasing expenditure and mortality. So, to help improve the notification process, the National TB Program came up with the policy to, first of all, mandate that TB is a notifiable disease. This happened in May 2012, and a web portal was created called Nikshay, which helps private providers can make the notification automatically into the Nikshay portal. Apart from this, there was a standard of TB care in India document provided to the private care providers, but unfortunately we do not know at this point how good the adherence is. If you looked at what happened in the past, if you looked at the studies that were done, there's a study that was done in Mysore which assessed 2,500 private practitioners. And in this, when the doctors were interviewed, 80% of the doctors told that they did not diagnose or treat TB, which is kind of surprising considering the amount of prevalence of disease that we have in the country. And of the doctors who are managing TB, 70% of the doctors were not even aware that TB is a notifiable disease. And those who were aware that the TB is notifiable, 95% of the doctors did not know how to notify. And some of the doctors raised concerns about patients' confidentiality, the perceived threat that the physicians may have in terms of patients being lost once they notify. And there were a lot of other concerns that came up. So it was also found that about 30% of the patients were lost to follow-up. So in essence, we have a poor notification system and no treatment adherence mechanisms available. So to help solve some of these problems, the union along with Apollo came up with the mechanism whereby we can do notification to Nikshay and also monitor treatment adherence. We came up with the strategy to engage basically corporate hospitals. Part of the strategy was also to update the knowledge of physicians on diagnosis and management of TB, both drug-sensitive and drug-resistant TB, to notify TB patients, and to ensure adherence, and to thereby improve the outcomes to favorable outcome. A web-based software was developed. This software helps register the patients, track and monitor TB patients. It also has mechanisms in it to provide reminders for taking medication, for follow-up visits and tests. This is pilot tested with Apollo Hospital. Now what happens here is, when the patient comes, enrolls into the hospital, the patient's demographic information is available in the hospital information system. And when the patient is diagnosed with or started on treatment for tuberculosis, the notification system starts off. The social worker puts into the system the patient demographics, patient diagnosis, and this patient demographics, which is already in the hospital information system, is also entered. And this information is entered into the website. The notification, the website is automatically communicating with the NICSHARE website, so the notification happens. Apart from the notification, the software also ensures that the patients get daily SMS messages to remind them to take the medications. And there's an integrated voice response call system whereby the patients get calls twice a week to asking them questions if they're taking medications or taking partial medications or not taking medications. And this information is captured on the website that we have created. If the patients are not taking medications, that information is communicated to the social worker and thereby to the doctors. If the patients are not taking the medications for any reason, then the patients are contacted and counseled them to take the medications. So this web-based tool basically registers the patients, tracks the patients, and monitors the patient. Also, reminders are provided that the appointment is due so that they can come, and if they do not come, that's tracked as well, and reminders are sent to the patients so that they can come back. The website also initiates automatic calls, and we are able to create a report, generate reports of the patients that are not coming out, not taking medications, to help improve the quality of care. So we initiated this project in June 2015, and till about March 2015, we have enrolled about 500, March 2017, we have enrolled about 500 patients into the system, and all of these patients have been notified to the NICSHARE portal. And so the government knows that we are taking care of these patients. If you try to figure out what kind of patients we've had, about two-thirds, about 75% of the patients had extrapulmonary tuberculosis, and 25% of the patients had pulmonary tuberculosis. Majority were male, about 200 females. And we had a fair number of drug-resistant TB patients as well. Okay. Among the 500 patients, 151 patients had successfully completed treatment. 203 patients are still undergoing treatment. We did find that about 80 patients have shifted to other hospitals, primarily because this is a referral hospital and patients would want to continue the treatment in their hometown. And we were not able to track about 11 patients, and 22 patients were lost to follow-up as well. So we total patients that we've lost to care were about 30 patients. 27 patients died of various causes. In terms of monitoring them for the SMS and IVRS system, but 70% of patients consented to getting SMS and IVRS calls. Of the IVRS of the patients in the IVRS system, 95% of them have taken all doses, but 6% have missed one or more doses. And the feedback that we had from the patients, 93% of the patients found that the SMS and the IVRS were useful and wanted to continue, but about close to 10% of the patients did say that the frequency is too frequent, we can decrease the frequency. And the cost for this program that we have done comes to about $2 per patient. So by this, our notification is more convenient. we are able to monitor treatment adherence and hopefully prevent drug-resistant TB. We also looked at what are the kind of patients we are seeing. We had, again, 30 multidrug-resistant patients and one extensively drug-resistant patient. And close to 80% of the patients had other comorbidities. Diabetes was the number one. Again, this being a corporate hospital, our HIV numbers were slightly less. Other comorbidities we found were COPD, chronic lung disease, alcohol, and smoking. We tried to compare our outcomes as well. And if we looked at the patients who have had given consent to IVRS system, 83% have completed treatment or still are on treatment, compared to 69% of in the group that had not given consent to the IVRS systems. In terms of patients who have shifted to other hospitals, it was equal in both the systems. Whether they have given consent to IVRS or not did not make a difference. So we have tried to scale this up to other hospitals, and we are now enrolled two other hospitals in the system, and we are trying to extend it to other hospitals as well. So this is kind of the data that we've had from the other hospitals. We're still working on that. So to summarize, basically, the software helps us improve notification and linking our medical information system to the Nikshay portal. And that improves, this also has helped improve our adherence. We do provide regular reminders for medication and follow-up visits. And patients have had better follow-ups because of this. We do have weekly feedback on the regularity of drug intake through interactive voice calls. This helps us in regularly monitoring the adherence system, and by making sure that the adherence is better, we hopefully decrease the amplification of resistance. This has also made notification a little bit more convenient. And the important thing is we can remind and track patients for follow-up visits. When they do not come back for follow-up, we do have a mechanism to call them and ask them to come for follow-up. We are able to monitor the treatment outcomes as well. And this is data analysis is useful for policy guidance and operational research as well. So these are some of the outreach mechanisms that we have done. We have created provided the information that we have done in the media, and that hopefully has generated more interest in the population in terms of TB. And Cavensoft is a company that has helped us create this software along with the union. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sunita. Now ready, you have set the perfect stage to invite our next panelist, Dr. Archana Trivedi, Senior Technical Advisor with the International Union of Tuberculosis and Lung Disease, or the Union Southeast Asia Office. Let's listen in. It's now over to you, Dr. Trivedi.
Yes, Dr. Trivedi, please present. We are waiting to listen to you. Dr. Trivedi, can you hear me? Please unmute yourself.
Am I audible now, yes. Shobhaji?
Okay. Yes, now you are audible, yes.
Okay. I'll be sharing results of a pilot study which we have done it in tribal district of India. Does M Health aids to increase referrals, early diagnosis and treatment initiation of TB patients? Rural healthcare providers are first point of contact for curative services in remote geographical areas where we have got limited public health services. And identifying and ensuring testing of presumptive TB patients is a big constraint. Normally, a paper-based referral makes feedback on the results of the results to the referring physicians is suboptimal. Communicating test results is also vital for next course of action for the TB patients. These frontline workers who are rural healthcare providers and lab technicians often lack on information about referred test symptomatic cases. And also validating referrals is resource intensive, time consuming and difficult. Objective of our pilot study was to demonstrate effectiveness of mHealth mobile platform for real-time referrals, early diagnosis and treatment initiation of TB patients in a tribal district of India. The site which we had selected and where implementation was done is Khuti district, which is in Jharkhand state. Khuti has got a population of nearly 5 lakhs, in which 1 lakh of which is below poverty line. Khuti is a tribal district and population here is isolated with poor livelihood conditions. We are implementing this pilot study in 3 blocks of the Khuti, which are Khuti, Muru and Torpa. And here we have selected rural healthcare providers. Few of them were using mobiles and rest were referring the symptomatic cases through non-mobile. These rural healthcare providers are very popular and they envisage a community of health worker at village level. Over the years, they have actually earned confidence and trust in the community they serve. They are mobile and they move into the interiors of the villages and their qualification is varied, which is actually not health related, which varies from secondary level qualification to graduation and post-graduation. We have developed a mobile application in collaboration with Dimagi, which is an open source platform and easily customizable. This pilot project was done in 3 blocks of district, as I mentioned, in Khuti, covering a population of nearly 45,000. This application tracks referrals, follow-up of diagnosis, and treatment of tuberculosis patients, tuberculosis efficiently. A real-time central database is created, which helps us for the operational research and follow-up of the patients to give them proper treatment and so that they adhere to treatment and get cured. These are 2 interoperable modules of our application. One is used by the rural healthcare providers and NGO supervisor, and other is used by the lab technicians. The module for the rural healthcare providers has got a referral form in which the patient details are entered, and it has also got a video with the counseling messages on various thematic areas. If the patient doesn't reach microscopy center within 7 days for a test, the patient, NGO supervisor, rural healthcare provider, they receive SMS with the patient information to follow up. The application also has a DOTS protocol which helps to track the patient for adhering to the treatment. The module for lab technician has got a recording for sputum examination in which results of the sputum examination are entered by the lab technician. We had a control arm of 69 rural healthcare providers who were referring these presumptive TB patients through non-mobile, and 25 rural healthcare providers which were in intervention arm who were referring to the mobile applications. We also had 3 lab technicians who were using the mobile application so that we could create an interface between the healthcare providers in the private sector, non-qualified healthcare providers, and the lab technicians. This is the flow of the application. It's an Android-based application. Rural healthcare provider, when they identify presumptive TB patients, after entering the patient details, they refer the patients, and the information reaches to lab technician. At the same time, it reaches to the NGO supervisor also. After the lab technician does the sputum examination, he enters the result of the sputum examination, which is informed to the rural health provider, NGO supervisor, as well as to the presumptive TB patients. If the patient doesn't reach the microscopy center within 7 days, the information is sent to the patient as well as RHCPs and NGO supervisor so that they can follow up with the patients and the patient can reach microscopy center for sputum testing. These are the various audio-visual clips on counseling messages, which are on cough etiquette and adhering to treatment for complete cure. These are key findings of the application. We had done a comparative analysis between the mobile users and non-mobile users. Presumptive TB patients were nearly 1,300 with in intervention arm compared to 700 in control arm. And successful referrals per RHCP was 41 compared to non-mobile 10, that is fourfold increase in successful referrals. That means referrals who had reached microscopy center and got tested also. And diagnosed TB patients per RHCP was also through an intervention of 7 compared to control arm 2. And diagnosis within 1 day of referral was done through mobile in 57% of the patients and 29% in non-mobile. And treatment initiation within 7 days of diagnosis was done in 55% in mobile users and 30% in non-mobile users. Thus, through this app, we can enhance referrals, reduce delay in diagnosis, as well as initiate early treatment of TB patients which were diagnosed through this application. This is a graphical representation of what I had mentioned about the successful referrals and the TB patients which were diagnosed. It's nearly 4 times which you would get an additional yield through the mobile application. So we have got an inference that this mobile technology, mHealth, increases referrals, early diagnosis and treatment initiation of TB patients. It creates a real-time central database which helps in retrieval and follow-up of the TB patients. It facilitates compilation and analysis of data. This application is first of its kind for rural healthcare providers to facilitate identification, referral of presumptive TB patients, and track them to ensure testing, link those diagnosed with treatment services. Thus, this mHealth can be used in tribal areas also where use of apps is considered to be low. This is the link of the application which has been uploaded on YouTube. If anybody interested can go through it. That is all from my end, Shobhaji. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was Dr. Vedi.
I think our third panelist, Dr. Charles Sandy, is not
Dr.
there.
Alex.
Okay. So,
okay, yes. Great. So, you'll well now. Well, that brings us to the end of experts' presentation, and now we begin the open session. Participants, keep sending your questions using chat function or raise your virtual hand on the webinar screen. While it's open to sessions begins right now, it's over to you, Madam Shobhaji.
Thank you, Ashok. We already have a lot many questions streaming in. The first question is for Dr. Sunita Nar Reddy. How can we improve implementation of TB being notified by private practitioners since you are from the private sector? What more needs to be done for implementation of this law?
Dr. Good question. See, the major several issues that we have in the private sector. If you look at the private sector practice, as you know, most of the private physicians, they'll be seeing lots of patients on a daily basis. And one of the constant complaints that when I talk to my colleagues or other people in terms of notification, it takes time away from patient care. If I have patients waiting outside the room and they are waiting to see me, and if I'm going to have to spend a few minutes between each patient trying to do the notification process, it means that the patients outside are going to have a lot of complaints in terms of increasing wait time. So that's one of the problems. And then the other complaints that will say, doctors will say, my patients are VIP patients. I don't want to disclose their diagnosis to other people. Well, that is not a valid argument, because if it's a notifiable disease, irrespective of who is the patient, it has to be notified. So you do have to notify. In terms of what we have done to help address the initial problem, because physicians don't want to spend extra time to do the notification, we have a social worker with us who does all the notification for us. So for the entire hospital, we have one social worker, but any of the doctors in the hospital, if they have a patient with TB, those patients are referred to the social worker who will do the notification, as well as we maintain the database of all of these patients. So it helps us in both ways. One, it helps us in notification, and two, it helps us in terms of monitoring the follow-up. To make sure that they're adherent to the treatment. So because of we are providing that second incentive to the patients, the doctors may be more inclined to do the notification, to send the patients to the social worker. And couple of other physicians are concerned about notification because they feel that somebody else is monitoring what I'm doing. Why should somebody monitor what I'm doing? Why should somebody, things like that. It just needs a lot of reinforcement and to the doctors also that this is something that we have to do to help improve the patient care in the long run, not necessarily for this particular patient. Because definitely it does take time, more time to take care of the patient than you would do without a notification. So it does take time, it does take a little bit more effort from the physician, but the time is well spent. We need to kind of reinforce this thought into the doctors on a constant basis.
Okay, thank you. We have Dr. P.S. Sarma, a senior TB expert and part of the organizing committee of NATCON 2017 with us, and he wants to add something to this response. Dr. P.S. Sarma, please. Dr. Sarma, would you like to ask? Okay, we move on to the next question meanwhile, and we'll get back to Dr. Sarma. Peter Oviti from Kenya wants to ask a question. If Peter wants to ask himself, he's welcome. Peter, please unmute yourself and ask. Okay, I will read his question. Peter wants to know what was the level of education of the patients and who pays for their data bundle or data pack? Archana or Dr. Naredi, either of you can answer this.
I can tell from what we are doing here. The patients that we get in the Apollo Hospital, which is one of the more hospital which takes care of more of the higher income people, but we do see patients from all spectrum of life. We have the highly patients from programmers, software programmers, to IAS officers, to judges, to people who are laborers. We do have patients who are electricians. All kinds of patients do come here, so the education level is significantly varied. About half, at least half the patients that we see here are at least graduated school. In terms of who is paying for this notification, right now the software is a software that has been provided in collaboration with the union, and so the funding came from the union. The social worker at this point in time is again supported by the union. The hospital has agree to take on the responsibility of providing a social worker for this purpose once the funding for the social worker goes away also. Archana?
Yes,
Dr. Sunita, since we had two different models, like one was for the elite class of group, like another in the rural setting, you can say it's a rural and urban setting, like, so education, like, of at both the levels was different, as you mentioned, qualification of the patients who were coming to the Apollo Hospital was basically well-educated people who were software engineers and all, but at the same time, the tribal district where we had implemented the project and used the mobile health, here patients, they were actually, it's a basically tribal built, and they were not well educated. So through this system, actually, we were able to refer the patients and give them, including in the app itself, there are counseling messages. So we don't need to have a separate HR person like over there, and to the app itself we can do the counseling, and these are very pictorial messages which convey various information. So your patients, their qualification, they were not well educated patients like in the tribal areas. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Samuel Misoi of NTP Kenya wants to ask a similar question. Dr. Samuel, would you like to ask yourself? Just to let everybody know, Dr. Samuel played a key role in the rollout of drugs. Yes, Dr. Samuel.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please do.
Okay. I was looking at the links between the rural healthcare provider and the lab. Because like in Kenya, we lose a lot of cases in the laboratory who are diagnosed, but they are not brought for treatment. How is that done? Maybe could she explain a little bit more how she does it to ensure that all cases are initiated for treatment within 7 days?
Should I answer?
Yes, either of you can answer, Dr. Rath.
Okay.
Yes, please.
Since in the application where I had shown that patients were not reaching microscopy center within 7 days, the information was going to the NGO supervisor as well as the patient and rural healthcare providers. So that was actually a link to follow up the patients, allows to follow up. At the same time, for the patients who are diagnosed, like for the treatment initiation also, actually the gap which is there, like in spite of the fact if some patients are referred, the information about their result is not informed. But through this software, we were able to inform the result of this their sputum test also. So that was actually helping us to reduce delay in treatment initiation also. Because as soon as the lab technician was entering the result of the sputum examination on a real-time basis, the information was received by NGO supervisor as well as the rural health provider. This helped them to actually follow up with the patient and start the treatment at earliest.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sharon Cox of LSHTM wants to ask a question. Sharon, would you like to ask yourself?
I can unmute.
Yes, yes, yes. You can be heard. We can hear you.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, yes.
Oh, okay, thank you. Interesting presentation. I just wanted to ask about the first presentation and whether it was using an open source platform that others could adapt to different situations.
Yes, Sharon. This is an open source platform. It has been designed so that anyone can use the same platform with minimal changes.
That's great. Thank you.
Just to add on to Dr. Sunita, what she mentioned, like, we, apart from Apollo, we Union Southeast Asia office is replicating the same model in various other hospitals also. So it is adaptable and it is being in other hospitals in India, Hindutva Hospital, Mumbai, KIMS Trivandrum. So we are actually now scaling it up, this application.
Okay,
Okay, thank you, Dr. Javedi. We have a comment from Dr. R.K. Sood, Senior TB Expert and District TB Officer of Kangra in Himachal Pradesh, India. Dr. Sood says, mHealth can be useful, but capacity building of the health staff is crucial. What do our panelists have to say to that?
Absolutely.
Yes. Are there problems you face by way of capacity building?
Yeah, should I answer?
Yes, please do.
Yeah. Dr. Sood, capacity building of healthcare providers right now, what I had experienced it wasn't very difficult, because with the cellular network, the way it is increasing in low and middle income countries, it's actually everybody was having in the interiors of the district also, most of the, especially the healthcare providers, they were having these Android phones. Apart from these rural health providers who were already having the Android phone, we rarely see in fields right now, especially with the healthcare providers, those featured phones. Actually, it wasn't a very challenging job, especially to build capacity of healthcare providers to use this mobile app. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. P.S. Sarma wants to add, he wants to share his experience, and he says that as one of IMA RNTCP consultants, I have sensitized IMA doctors and trained some of them on how to notify and upload on Nikshay. And as a result, nearly 100,000 TB patients were notified and uploaded on Nikshay during 2013-2015. Good work, Dr. Sarma. Please continue with it. We have a question from Yosarianto Tahir from Indonesia. Would Tahir like to ask the question?
Yeah, hello.
Yes, hello, we can hear you. Yes, yeah. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. How do you engage the patient? Is it for mandatory or voluntary? And how do you think will suitable setting in the future? Is it we need to make it mandatory, or we just voluntary to offer to the patient? Thank you.
We would like both the panelists to answer, perhaps. Dr. Trivedi.
Dr. Shukla, can you repeat the question? I didn't get it.
He wants to ask, how do you engage the patient? Is it mandatory or voluntary? And how do you think it will be used in future settings? Would you make it mandatory or voluntary? Engaging the patient through mHealth or through the mobile?
Can I take the question?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. We're treating the patient with the disease. Unless we have the engagement of the patient, we cannot get good outcomes. It's absolutely important the patient understands what is happening to them, so that you can get their cooperation in the treatment. Otherwise, once the patient feels a little bit better, they're going to stop taking medications, and that's the time when they're going to develop drug resistance. So in terms of engaging patients, it's very, very important. How do we improve that? Basically, by having a constant dialogue. Every time they come to see us, we have to make sure we reinforce the same discussions about the disease, the mail, and compliance for the treatment. And also, what helps is that informing the patients of potential side effects ahead of time. If they don't know that the medications that they will take have side effects, if they develop the side effects, then they'll stop coming to you. They think that you're a bad doctor, they'll stop medications and they'll go to someone else, and the whole process continues. So counseling the patients appropriately about the disease process, this drug side effects, how to take the medications, and the importance of taking the medications on a regular basis is mandatory. And this is where having an additional person to support you helps. For example, now with our program, we have a social worker who helps us with this counseling and reinforcement. The second time definitely helps.
Thank you. Dr. Trivedi, would you like to add something to that?
Yeah, just to add to what Dr. Sunita mentioned, like definitely engaging patients is essential, but at the same time it's a little difficult to make it mandatory. So in the software which is being used at Apollo Hospital, we have got a option of taking the consent for the from the patients whether they would like to get these reminders or not. Depending upon that, we those reminders are sent to the patients. At the same time, we have got in the software the option of if later, after the counseling is continuing with the patient, if later the patient wants to change and wants to, suppose initially they have not given the consent and they want to change and they want to give the consent, so it can be modified. So actually the software which has been developed for the private sector is a complete which covers up everything, including if even if they don't want to engage themselves initially, later on with the continuous counseling that can be changed. So it's useful through which through the IVRS action taken and all, patient can be followed and they can change their mind for getting. Even if they initially they had refused for consent, they can actually change their mind and give the consent for these reminders and all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Trivedi. So we have to keep the human rights issue right in focus. Yes. We have a question from Dr. Abha Jaiswal for Dr. Archana Trivedi. She wants to know, is it possible to scale up the Kunti intervention to other parts of the country, are there any possibilities of doing that?
Yeah, it's an open source software which is a CompCare, and it's easily customizable, so it can be used and it can be replicated easily. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from another Indian journalist, Bhavna Wal. She wants to know about the Indian scenario. How practical is mHealth technology vis-a-vis traditional public health approaches? I'm sure both of you would be having first-hand experience on that. The practicality of technology.
I can start off here and Rachna can take over. mHealth is not just used in tuberculosis alone. It's the way healthcare is changing, it's very dynamic. We are using mobile health not just in this, in a lot of things. This kind of system would help in most of your other non-infectious conditions. For example, chronic diseases like tuberculosis, diabetes. In our hospital, we have a similar system in diabetes management. You're also using mobile health in reaching out to remote areas for other conditions. Like, for example, we have a tele-ICU where we support ICUs in other places where they do not have the support systems where senior doctors are available. So mobile health is something that is coming in, and we just have to accept it and accept the it's really very, very useful in a lot of other conditions. It's a challenge to establish in the first place, but once it's established and people know how to use it, it's very, very useful. Because it's very difficult to reach out to every single house or every single city or village. And when we have technology, we need to make use of it. Archana?
Thank you, Dr. Trivedi.
Yes, definitely, Dr. Sunita. Initially, it's very challenging, but maybe in years to come, actually, it's need of the hour. Where when we are moving towards digital India, we need to actually use these technologies. Like, and these are showing the results. Through this technology, we are able to bridge those gaps which are there. We can that communication. Is actually it can be easily facilitated between the healthcare providers and the patients as well as the public health sector also. So in times to come, these results will be helpful to replicate. And at the same time, whatever we have developed, it many these can be used for various other diseases. As you are mentioning, we are already Apollo is already using for diabetes and other diseases also. Same way, right now also we are going to replicate similar models in bronchopneumonia and for DM also. So these will be actually useful and can bridge plenty of gaps which are there and to strengthen the health system.
Thank you. We have a question from Roger Paul Kamagusha. Roger, would you like to ask your question? Would you like to ask? Okay, I will ask on his behalf. Roger wants to know, how do we monitor patients in the private sector? This is a major challenge in Uganda too, from where he comes. mHealth is working, but what more?
Roger, as you realize that in the private sector, it's actually a huge challenge to monitor the patients because there is no set mechanism. Once they leave the hospital or the clinic, there is no way or systems established to make sure that the patients are under treatment, taking treatment, not taking treatment. There is no way to reach out to them, which is why this system is helpful, because we are trying to engage the patients by introducing the integrated voice response system, whereby if the patients do take the medications, they inform us, or if they're not taking, it's a simple thing. We send a message, the patients receive a phone call saying that if you're taking a message, press 1. If you're not taking all of your medications, press 2. If you're taking some of your medications, press 3. All they have to do is press a number. There are times when we have issues even in this. For example, patients may press the wrong button. They may keep telling us that they're taking the medications and not taking the medications. Yes, there are challenges, but these are methods that we are coming up with to help improve the patient compliance and track them down. And we should be communicating with the patients. For example, if they're supposed to come back for a follow-up, sending a reminder message that they're supposed to come, and if they do not come, again following up with them to come. It helps definitely with the patient care, and by doing that, it also helps you that your patient footfalls also increase. So you can convince your administration saying that yes, there is some return of investment here, because if the patient footfalls increase, that helps the bottom line. So there are ways that we can innovatively do which will help patient quality and help the bottom line.
Very clearly explained, Dr. Narreddy. Participants, please keep sending your questions by typing in your questions using the chat function, or if you want to speak, you may raise your virtual hand. We have a question from Simi Oberoi, who wants to know, what kind of training is being given to the grassroots healthcare workers in operating this app? Who is responsible for the training? Apart from registration and follow-up, how do we ensure that patients are getting the treatment or not? Either or both of you can answer.
Archana, you want to take that?
Yeah. At a grassroots level, we are actually training these rural healthcare providers. And basically, through the mobile app, we just demonstrate through the PowerPoint presentations. We train them how the application has to be filled and how they can follow up with the patients. Right, the various modules are actually shown to them, and hands-on training is also done of these grassroots level workers. At the same time, after a patient is registered for follow-up with the patients, as I had mentioned in the workflow, after the patient is getting registered, we have got a follow-up mechanism through the various information which are going to the patient as well as to the NGO supervisor. So we have got a one key point person, a supervisor, an NGO supervisor, which are implementing partners. We've got an implementing partner, Sankal Jyoti, in that district, who after getting the information, follow up with the patients and help in getting treatment, proper treatment, and completing the treatment. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Trivedi, would you like to add something?
Dr. Trivedi, would you like? Dr. Na.
Okay. Thank you. We have another question that Niksha and other online tools, have they worked with other private care providers who don't work in settings which are internet enabled? Ayush, faith-based healers, pharmacies in rural areas, etc. Where there is problem of internet, how do we deal with them?
Should I answer?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. These applications, actually, the way we have developed and created an interface with the Niksha, these can be entered offline. However, they can be submitted later on, and they can be synced like when the net connectivity is there. So, we are replicating the same model in our Global Fund project, Akshaya project, where we have got a point persons in various districts where they collect that information from various private practitioners, hospitals, and they do the entry on their behalf. So even if at these areas where internet connectivity is not a problem, firstly, it can be entered offline and then can be submitted online and it can be synced, or we have got an option of one point person who collects the data from various practitioners and hospitals and do the entry on their behalf.
Can I add
similar to like software? Yeah, Dr. Sunita, you can add.
Dr. Shobha, see, one way of doing it is online, which is the easiest modality today. But for people who do not want to use the online access, the government still takes the paper and pen route as well. You are given the option of giving all your data entered in the standard format that the government has. You fill in the forms and send it over to the district health officer, and they will take it on from there.
Okay. Thank you. We have a question from Dr. Nachiket Sule. He wants to know if there are difficulties in using mHealth in recording follow-ups and relapse patients on the app, because with certain mHealth apps, some patients are lost to follow-up and referrals. How is this app handling these issues? How do you handle the practical difficulties of recording relapse patients?
In our database of 500 patients, we have about 10 patients who have not responded, or 20 patients who have been lost to follow-up. These patients are patients who you're not able to track down their phone numbers and able to reach out to them. Yes, that is a challenge. It's difficult, or if the patients switch off the phone or refuse to answer the phone calls. We do face such situations. We try to reach out to them the next time they come, if they come for follow-up, and try to counsel them. And I think we had another 10 patients who just were not trackable at all because they've given some wrong information for some reason. These are challenges we do still face. We have not yet completely found a good solution to that. One way would be to go to make a house visit. Unfortunately, we don't have the wherewithal or resources to do that because we do have patients coming from far. Quite a few of our patients are from out of city, so we just can't reach out to them. I'm not sure if Ashna has some other solutions for that.
Dr. Sunita, just to add on, probably in big cities like Hyderabad and all, it's difficult to follow up and do the home visits and all. But at the same time, in a tribal area where we are implementing the same health, we have got a one point person as NGO supervisor who has got all the information of the complete loop, like whether the patient has been referred, whether the result of the sputum examination has been conveyed or not. So he is the point person, and he do actually visits the patients and tries to follow it with them, link them with the district health authorities, link them with the local ASHA workers, link them with the rural healthcare providers who are locally in that village. So probably in rural area, it's little easy to do it because they can easily actually home visit such patients who are lost to follow up. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I think the whole idea is to move from good to better and still more better. And I think that is what we are all trying to do. Waseem Khan wants to ask a question. Waseem, would you like to ask yourself? We are just running short of time. So I think I would read his question. Waseem wants to know, how can we get access to software being used at Apollo hospitals as well as mHealth application for enhancing referrals?
Prashna, you want to take that?
Yeah, regarding mHealth, like in the rural areas, like it's a ComCare platform which we are using. It's an open source platform which can be used, and same is for with this web-based software. It's also open source. They can be in touch with us. We can actually link and provide the software, and basically the cost, as Dr. Asmita also mentioned, like per patient cost wise, it's just comes out to be just $2 for 6 months of treatment. So web-based software that is already ready, which can be replicated and can be used, they can be actually in touch with them, can be in touch with us. So accordingly, we can link with the developers who have developed with, this software.
Okay. Thank you. I would just like to tell the participants that if you see the handout section of webinar tool on your instrument, laptop, mobile phone, or whatever, you will get to read the study of which Dr. Archana is a co-author. It is a study on mHealth and TB. And you can also see the video of the demo of the mobile app. It is there under handouts. It would be on your screens. Both are uploaded in the handouts. And I would like to end by a suggestion from Sharon of London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. She says, is anyone investigating linking outlying clinics to intranet networks by point-to-point microwave links to central hubs? These are now quite cheap and can cover 10 kilometers at least. So I think that leaves us with some food for thought. And with that, we come to an end.
Thank you, Dr. Shukla, Dr. Trivedi, and Dr. Sandy.
Thank you. Any other last minute remarks which Dr. Trivedi or Dr. Naredi would like to make?
Thank you, Dr. Sunita Naredi. She was very supportive to us for implementing this software and getting the results. And Shobhaji, actually, through this, we have developed two types of models which can be used at in the rural setting as well as at the urban setting, and these are easily replicable and open source.
Thank you very much. We now come to the end of this webinar. Yes, yes, please. Sorry.
I would also like to take this opportunity to thank my social worker Astra, who without whose support we could not have done any of this.
Okay, thank you, Astra.
And Kevin for their support for helping us do this project.
Okay. Thank you to all the panelists and participants for participating in today's webinar and enriching it with their valuable inputs. Special thanks to the union for helping us host the webinar. The webinar recording will be made available to all of you as always. Goodbye and have a good day.
Thank you, Jay.